This section is on the religious sisters who came to the area. As anthracite coal production and the population of the county increased, so did the needs of the community. The church was the center of life for the various ethnic groups due to their differing languages and cultures, as I mentioned before. And as congregations grew, the religious sisters answered the call. The Sisters of Mercy came from Ireland, the Sisters of Christian Charity from Germany, and the Bernardine Sisters from Poland, just to name a few. The sisters served as teachers, administrators, and nurses. Sisters of Mercy founded College Misericordia and Mercy Hospital and taught at Misericordia's St. Aloysius School and St. Mary's High School, Wilkes-Barre, St. Vincent School, Plymouth, and many others. The Sisters of Christian Charity taught at St. Nicholas School, and the Bernardine Sisters taught at Marymount High School, St. Stanislaus, Nanticoke, Saints Peter and Paul's in Plains, Transfiguration School, West Hazleton, and Sacred Heart of Jesus School in DuPont, for example. So we have some pictures here. We have the Bernardine Sisters at Sacred Heart of Jesus School in DuPont. That's around 1931 to 32. Anyone who went to Catholic school will recognize those habits. They were, you know, heavy and covered everything. Below we have a picture of St. Stanislaus Orphanage, and that was an orphanage that was run by the Bernardine Sisters. And below we have some pictures of the inside of the orphanage. Then we have some Sisters of Mercy from St. Vincent's Church in Plymouth. There's Sister Mary Carmel and Sister Mary Vincent de Paul. And above that, Sisters of St. Cyril and Methodius, who were stationed at St. Stephen's Parish in Plymouth. So there were many orders of sisters who came here, either from directly from the country of their origin or sometimes from a mother house that was already established somewhere else in the United States. They would come to this area to serve. We have some pictures here of Mercy Hospital. There's a... some sisters training nurses at Mercy around 1960. And below that is a picture of the original Mercy Hospital, which was founded by the Sisters of Mercy in 1899 down in South Wilkes-Barre. That was the original hospital, was in that house. And then below that is the Mollenkraut Convent, which was home of the Sisters of Christian Charity who came from Germany to teach in Wilkes-Barre. And then this is a picture of the groundbreaking for College Misericordia in 1921. The Ku Klux Klan actually burned crosses on the lawn of College Misericordia before that. They were trying to stop them from building the school. They didn't want them here. But those sisters didn't back down. They built the school anyway. And here's a picture of that. This was the whole school in 1924, Mercy Hall, which is now the administration building at what is now Misericordia University. And then in the case here, we have a yearbook from Marymount High School, and then a string of rosary beads, which the sisters used to carry on their belts. Again, if you went to Catholic school or were a Mercy nurse, you'll remember the nurses or the sisters wearing those rosary beads. Now, coal was not the only industry which dominated the Luzerne County's economy in the 19th and early 20th centuries. As the Industrial Revolution grew in the United States, silk mills, underwear manufacturers, dress factories, and other textile industries moved to the area where there was a large potential workforce in the wives and daughters of the mine workers. As with the coal industry, these factories were places with terrible and often dangerous working conditions. Women and young girls worked with open machinery in cramped quarters for long hours in these sweatshops. Intolerable conditions and low wages gave rise to labor union activity. The International Ladies Garment Workers Union had a powerful representative in Luzerne County in the 1940s in the person of Min Matheson, who put her life on the line for her cause and fought the underworld with the one thing hoodlums couldn't cope with, women. That was a quote from Min Matheson. So our factory workers are represented here. We have some machinery, a piece of machinery from the Pan Am Silk Mill in South Wilkes-Barre. This is a coning machine. You can see the cardboard cones are on a couple of these pieces here, and this would be whirring constantly, and winding thread onto those cones, and then that's how the thread was sold on those cones. So a woman would have to tend this machine and keep changing out those cones quickly as it would spin and fill them up. We have some early pictures here of women working in silk mills or textile mills. There's an engraving here on the top. It shows the overseer and the women at their stations. These are weaving machines in this particular picture. And then below, we have two women working here in a textile mill. It's similar to the coning machine. There are spools on there, and they have to change those out and keep an eye on things, make sure things are running smoothly. But they had to stand all day, and often the air was filled with fibers from the textiles themselves. So it was a similar situation to what they had in the mines, where the air was always filled with something that wasn't good for you. And they didn't have any ventilation, so that's why they called them sweatshops, because they got very hot. Here's some weavers standing outside of the Hess Goldsmith Silk Mill on Walker Street in South Wilkes-Barre. That picture's from about 1891. The man in the picture there would be an overseer. So the overseers were men, but the women actually worked running the machines. And then we have this great picture from the Wilkes-Barre Centennial Parade in 1906. And this is the float that was put together by the Wilkes-Barre Lace Manufacturing Company. And you can see the women are wearing these elaborate mantillas that were made at the factory. One of the factories in the area that actually had good working conditions and was ahead of their time as far as providing benefits and things was the Planters Nut and Chocolate Company. Which Planters Peanuts started here in 1906. And we have some pictures here of the workers outside of the... this was an opening of one of the new factories. They had several factories in Wilkes-Barre initially, and then they moved the processing down to Suffolk, Virginia, although they kept the headquarters building here in Wilkes-Barre. And then we have some women working at cleaning and packing nuts at the company. This picture's from 1907, from a booklet that they produced that they would send out to their prospective buyers to show them the clean and up-to-date working conditions in their factory. And we even have a picture here of the women workers having lunch at the Planters Nut and Chocolate factory in 1907. And there's a sign in the back that says that if you have your lunch in the cafeteria there, that you get a free cup of coffee. So this is a far cry from the sweatshops, although I don't know what the temperature was like in there, but you know, they were the first to offer sick leave and paid vacation time and things like that. So they were really way ahead of their time. And then here's one more picture of Planters where the women are packing chocolates in the last phase of the operation. At that time, they had a lot of candy in their repertoire. Now it's just nuts, and it wasn't long after that they just went to nuts. But initially, they had a lot of chocolate as well. It's too bad they still don't, but... And then I mentioned earlier Min Matheson. She was quite a force to be contended with. And we have a picture of her here leading a strike. She was a labor leader, and she was district manager for Wyoming Valley's International Ladies Garment Workers Union. And she's pictured here, right here, third from the left, leading the Violet dress strike in Pittston in 1946. And then above, we have a picture of the members of the Ladies Garment Workers Union helping out at the Salvation Army truck during the Knox Mine disaster in 1956. So again, these women, they were in this International Ladies Garment Workers Union to get better pay and better benefits and things as workers, but they also did community service as part of that. So they were still giving back, you know, even though they were the main purpose of the union was for them to get their rights. In the case here, we have some other factory items. The pieces that are hanging on the block there and the white skeins down here in the front are actually raw silk. So that was the silk that was delivered to the factory and had to be made, spun into thread and put on these spools or cones. And these are just some other items that were used in the Pan Am Silk Mill in South Wilkes-Barre.
When you're out there, there's no telling what you'll find.
I see it, I see it.
Oh, look at you.
There are some moments only the forest can inspire. Find yours at discovertheforest.org.
From wildfires.
When I'm older, I want to be a singer. That's my goal.
An organizer of like do-gooders.
A media mogul. Just rule the world.
When I'm older, I want to be anything but the one that doesn't fit in. The one that people don't love.
Everyone deserves a dream.
Everyone.
But some of us feel depressed, anxious, angry, and do things that others think aren't normal.
If that's you, say something.
People will listen. Add your voice at okaytotalk.org.
Time to wake up. I've got a job to do today.
I've got a job to do today.
Don't forget, you've got a job to do today.
Hey, Mom. I got the job.
I've got the job. Welcome aboard.
Have a good first day at work, Mom.
Your donations to Goodwill fund job training programs right in your community.
Feels good to start fresh, right?
Sure does.
And like that, you're a job creator.
Cancer will strike more than 175,000 kids worldwide this year alone. The likelihood that teens and young adults will survive cancer is far greater when treated by pediatric oncologists. Survival can depend on experts in childhood cancer and collaborative groundbreaking research. To learn how you can help keep these kids in play, go to stbaldrick's.org/inplay or standuptocancer.org/pediatrics.
There's a shelter pet who wants to meet you. Meet one today. Visit theshelterpetproject.org. Adopt.
The teaching profession was another area that which was dominated by women in the 19th century. And where would we be without our teachers? Teaching was one of the few careers open to women in the 19th century, although it was for single women only. If you married, you had to leave your position. Even in the early 20th century, if a woman married, she could no longer be a teacher. Many small colleges, such as East Stroudsburg, started out as normal or teaching schools. And we have some pictures here, again, we just have some school pictures, but we also have a couple of women who were influential in education in the 19th century. This is the principal of the Wilkes-Barre Institute, Miss Elizabeth Rockwell, and that is her picture in 1885. There were a lot of independent schools, just small schools. A woman could have like a kindergarten or a nursery school in her home. And this is one of those, May Tompkins School from 1890. That's for very young children. Above here, we have a picture of the Roosevelt School with the teacher on the right there. And you can see the students are at different ages. But they were all taught in the same classroom. This is a picture of the Oliver School in Bear Creek in 1940. And you can see the female teacher in the background there. And this is a picture of Wilkes-Barre Institute. That looks like it's probably a kindergarten class, or first grade maybe. Here in the case we have some old primers or school books. This one is my favorite. It shows them teaching the children to iron dolls' clothes. And what else are they doing? Washing hands before lunch. And then we have a spelling book. And here's a phonics book that's open. And the slate, in the early days, you would carry your slate. And slate, they're like pencils, but they write on the slate. And the eraser, that's all connected together, so you didn't lose anything. Here's a desk that some people might remember, the one-piece desk with the place underneath for the books, although this one doesn't have the inkwell, which I even remember having an inkwell in my desk when I was in school. This is from Nanticoke School, and it was actually recently donated to the Historical Society, so we put it in our exhibit here. Up on the wall, we have Newport Township School in 1910. Again, you can see that's at a house that was set up as a school. And we have a picture of a teaching student here, Annie Brady Norris. This was her portrait taken while she was studying at East Stroudsburg Normal School. Now currently called East Stroudsburg University. And above here we have Ellen Webster Palmer with some Breaker Boys. Mrs. Palmer founded the Boys Industrial Association in 1891 to improve the present and future lives of working boys, not just Breaker Boys, but Shoeshine Boys and newspaper newsies. She moved here from Plattsburgh, New York, with her husband, who was Attorney General of Pennsylvania and a congressman and a local attorney. And she was appalled to see these young boys who cursed and swaggered and smoked like men. And she could see that they had no future. They started working very young in the breakers, and that was pretty much their life. They were going to work in the coal mines forever. And so she started this Boys Industrial Association, which was like a night school. She understood that they had to go to school to make money for their families, but she felt she had a responsibility to help them get out of that rut. And so she taught, in addition to reading, writing, and arithmetic, they also had courses, like trade courses in shoemaking, seat caning, carpentry, and things like that, so that the boys could learn a trade. But many boys went on from that school to become businessmen and men of repute in all over the country. Thousands of boys went through this school in the 20 or so years that it existed. And so she really made a great contribution. Another teacher who was very involved in education, just beyond being a teacher, was Fanny Sachs Long. She began with teaching domestic skills at Temple B'nai B'rith, but she became involved in education issues throughout the community. She chaired the Kindergarten Federation of the Young Men's Hebrew Association Education Committee, the Women's Clubs Committee on Illiteracy. She helped organize the city's PTA and playground centers and founded the Valley's first Girl Scout troop. We mentioned her early on in the volunteer section. And she also founded the college, now known as the University Women's Club. And then we just have a couple other pictures of teachers that we found in our collections. Miss Hahn, who was a senior college chemistry professor in 1943. Not sure what school that was from, but... And then we have a Miss O'Brien, who was a science teacher on the right here. And then we have a picture from 1951 from Wilkes College, now Wilkes University, of Miss Dominguez, who was supervising an experiment there. And she was also a science teacher, professor. We don't have much cause to talk to telephone operators anymore, unless they're maybe telemarketers, but telephone companies employed switchboard operators into the 1960s. This person would connect calls by inserting a pair of phone plugs into the correct jacks. Callers would speak to an operator at a central office who then linked a cord to the appropriate circuit to complete the call. And here in Luzerne County, hundreds of women worked at the Bell, as they called it, which was Bell Telephone, as well as Commonwealth Telephone in Dallas. The world's first telephone operator was George Willard Croy, who was employed by the Boston Dispatch Company in 1878. And that same year, Emma Nutt, hired by Alexander Graham Bell himself, became the world's first female telephone operator for the same company. Prior to her hire, teenage boys were employed as operators. But Emma was hired as a response to the poor attitude and behavior of the boys, and from that time, women dominated the occupation. The Bell Telephone Company began in 1877 by Gardner Green Hubbard, who was Bell's father. He also aided in organizing the New England Telephone Company. The two merged in 1879 and with others later to form the American Bell Telephone Company, which later evolved into AT&T. So we have our telephone quilt square here, and we have some pictures of early operators. This one is very early, a very early switchboard operator. She's just sitting at a little place there with her hanging thing to talk into and a headset. And then she has a few plugs, switchboard in front of her where she can put a few plugs in. There's a little bit more modern from 1936 graphic of an operator connecting a call. And then these are switchboard operators who worked during the 1936 flood here in Wilkes-Barre. Well, it was beyond Wilkes-Barre, but these women were from the Wilkes-Barre section, and they helped to keep communications open during the flood while everything else was down. And here's another picture of Bell Telephone operators from Wilkes-Barre traffic, it was called. They went to Williamsport, actually, during the flood of 1936 to help out there with communications. And here's another picture of women sitting in rows at a switchboard. That's from the 1930s as well. And then we have a little Bell telephone bulletin, which you would have gotten with your phone bill. And it tells you just some information about the telephone service. But this the theme of this particular one is courtesy is catching. And it tells you the rules of courtesy if you have a party line, which means that you share the line with more than one family. And, you know, basic things like don't stay on the line for a long time. If somebody picks up to make a call from one of the other houses, you know, to finish up your call so they can make their call, that sort of thing. So that's hard for us to imagine today that at one time, you know, a number of families shared one party line. Things have changed quite a bit in that department. Now, this item here is called a gossip bench, which is a great name. It's a telephone table. It's a piece of furniture that was made specifically for the sitting and talking on the telephone. Once they had telephones that were not attached to the walls, this came into vogue. This one is from about 1950, and our telephone is from about 1970. I've had children come into the museum who don't know what that is or what to do with it, how to work it. But I'm sure many people remember the rotary phones. This one has a plastic dial. Originally, they were metal and came in different shapes, but basically this was the idea.
You fill up my senses like night in a forest, like the mountains in springtime, like a walk in the rain, like a storm in the desert, like a sleepy blue ocean. You fill up my senses, come fill me again. Come let me love you, let me give my life to you. Let me drown in your laughter, let me die.